North Korea has built up a reputation for being one of the strictest and most rigid countries in the world. From their tight control on immigration to their unforgiving labor camps, it's no question that North Korea is not messing around. One of the most notable aspects of North Korea has been their missile and rocket development effort. The media has been pointing to this as being a major threat for decades now, and leaders around the world have consistently tried to get North Korea to denuclearize. As the world powers move into space and create things like the US Space Force, however, will North Korea be able to keep up, or is nuclear technology their last hurrah? Well, here's everything we know about North Korea's elusive space agency. Taking a look back, North Korea did not establish a space program for quite some time after World War II. It wasn't until the 1980s that North Korea created the Korean Committee of Space Technology, or the KCST. The KCST was originally responsible for everything related to the country's space effort, from designing new satellites to developing launch technology. The organization's first step, though, was building a launch facility. In the early 1980s, the KCST built the Tonghae Satellite Launching Ground in the North Hamgyong province. The construction effort wasn't super organized, though. The North Koreans built the launch facility on and off throughout the 1980s and 1990s. By 1985, they completed construction of their launch pad. But aside from that, they didn't have much to show after years of construction. They simply had a rudimentary command bunker, a radar facility, and a few storage and support buildings. The initial goal was to just reverse engineer the Soviet Scud rocket and produce their own copies. So, the rudimentary infrastructure was enough for the time being. Throughout the 1990s, however, the North Koreans would significantly expand this facility. Reports suggest that the site grew from just 2 kilometers in length to 9 kilometers in length. The new additions included a missile assembly facility, a fuel storage facility, a guidance and range control center, and tracking facilities. As the Tonghae Satellite Launching Ground was finished up, the North Koreans shifted their effort to building a new launching site called the Sohae Satellite Launching Station. Construction began in the early 1990s, but like the Tonghae site, construction would stretch out for quite some time. It wasn't until 2011 that the site was completed. The North Koreans did get a lot of work done though, as the base ended up being 6 square kilometers, which is 5 times larger than the Tonghae site. Aside from being much larger, the Sohae site was also far more advanced, and included elements such as a static rocket motor test stand and a much more substantial mission control center instead of the command bunker they used to use. In terms of actual missions and space programs, the North Koreans have only had 3 substantial programs thus far, with the first one being Taepodong. Taepodong was the final result of trying to replicate the Soviet Scud rocket. The Scud rocket was a series of tactical ballistic missiles, so initially, there were fears that North Korea could use Taepodong as a surface-to-surface missile. But the US Defense Intelligence Agency would later suggest that Taepodong was simply a testbed. Anyway, in August of 1998, North Korea launched Taepodong 1. North Korean media reported that Taepodong 1 reached orbit within 5 minutes after launch, and that they had successfully launched their first satellite. But Western scientists disagree with this report. According to their observations, Taepodong 1 was launched, and it did reach an altitude of 200 kilometers. However, they suspect that the third stage failed to ignite, as the satellite never actually reached orbit. Based on where the third stage landed, scientists estimate that Taepodong could reach up to 5,900 kilometers if the mission was successful. And that brings us into their second attempt with Taepodong. North Korea launched Taepodong 2 in July of 2006, nearly 8 years after Taepodong 1. Unfortunately, there is absolutely no footage or images relating to this mission. But the US Department of Defense did confirm that the launch did in fact take place. There's not too much to discuss though, as the missile apparently failed just 40 seconds after launch. Though it doesn't seem like the reliability of the missile was improved, observers speculate that the missile was much more powerful. It's estimated that each stage of the missile could have a burn time of about 100 seconds, which translates to a total burn time of 5 to 6 minutes. With a bit of tweaks, this could allow for up to 9,000 kilometers of range with a payload capacity of up to 500 kilograms. Unfortunately for North Korea though, this would never materialize, and they would move on to a new series of rockets called Unha. Unha, which means galaxy, was basically a Frankenstein rocket that incorporated elements from a few different rockets. The first stage of Unha uses 4 Nodong motors, which are simply enlarged versions of Scud motors. Originally, the second stage was thought to be based on the Soviet SSN-6 missile. But now, the general consensus is that the second stage is also based on the Scud rocket. As for the third and fourth stages, these seem to be identical to the Iranian Saphir rocket's second stage. So, once again, it doesn't seem like North Korea added much themselves when designing the Unha rocket, as it's just a combination of Scud and Saphir. Despite this, the Unha rocket would stir up quite a bit of controversy. You see, according to the United Nations Security Council Resolution 1718, North Korea was prohibited from testing ballistic missiles, and as you might have guessed, Unha was a ballistic missile. The US, South Korea, and Japan would all raise red flags that this launch would violate the agreement. Even Russia urged North Korea to cancel the planned launch. Nonetheless, North Korea would go ahead and launch Unha 2 on April 5, 2009, according to South Korea. The US Northern Command identified that the first stage of the rocket fell into the Sea of Japan, and the other stages fell into the Pacific Ocean. The missile traveled a rather impressive 3,850 kilometers from the launch site, but the US suggests that the third stage did not actually separate, and that the rocket failed to insert anything into orbit. North Korea, however, still claims that the rocket was fully successful, and that it put a satellite into orbit. Moving on to their second launch of Unha, we have Unha 3, which took place in April of 2012. North Korea was actually super confident about this launch, and they even invited observers from 8 different countries to come observe the launch. But unfortunately for North Korea, the launch was a failure. We don't really have any details as to what exactly happened, but it does seem like North Korea was indeed super close to successfully launching a satellite. Just 8 months later, in December of 2012, another Unha 3 rocket was launched, and this rocket would successfully launch a satellite into sun-synchronous orbit. Though this was a massive milestone for the North Koreans, it wasn't all good news. A few days after the launch, Harvard astronomer John McDowell suggested that though the satellite had reached orbit, it was uncontrollably tumbling in orbit and the satellite had yet to transmit anything. Following the partially successful mission, the North Koreans decided that it was time to rebrand themselves. In April of 2013, they created a new space agency called the National Aerospace Development Administration, or NADA. I don't think North Korea realized that NADA means nothing in Spanish, but this coincidence has become a running joke within the media. Anyway, moving on to the final and most recent launch, we have another Unha 3 launch. This final launch took place in February of 2016, and it seems to be North Korea's first fully successful launch. The director of the Scientific Research Department of NADA confirmed that they had received photographs from the satellite, and thus far, there has been no evidence suggesting otherwise. So, North Korea does have the capability to launch small satellites into orbit. As for the satellites themselves, all of the North Korean satellites are part of the Kwangmyongsong program. China helped North Korea develop the first Kwangmyongsong satellite, and it seems like North Korea has simply been improving the Chinese design ever since. There have been a total of 4 satellites within this program thus far, and 2 of them have made it to orbit, with one of them tumbling around. These satellites are simply communication/Earth observation satellites, so they're thought to be completely benign. And that's basically everything we publicly know about North Korea's space agency. But that still leaves a question: how dangerous is North Korea's space agency? Well, the Center for Strategic and International Studies answered just that. According to the CSIS, there are 4 major threats that could come from North Korea's rocket/missile program, with the first being kinetic physical counter-space weapons, and more specifically, kinetic ASATs. ASAT stands for anti-satellite weapon, and as the name suggests, these weapons are used to destroy the satellites of other countries. Thus far, North Korea has not tested nor announced the development of any kinetic ASAT technology. Moreover, even if they wanted to, the CSIS suggests that North Korea still has several technological hurdles to cross to develop an ASAT, so these aren't a threat. Moving on to the second category, we have non-kinetic physical counter-space weapons. One example of such a weapon is launching a nuclear warhead into space and detonating it. Some sources suggest that North Korea is actually working on developing such a device. However, there have been no known tests thus far, and the CSIS doubts that North Korea has enough technology to create such a weapon. In 2013, a Chinese military commentator actually suggested that North Korea does possess this weapon. If this is true, then North Korea likely got it from China or Russia. But given that North Korea can't yet produce it themselves, it's nothing to be too worried about. Moving on, we have electronic counter-space weapons. This includes technology that can jam GPS and communication signals from satellites. North Korea does actually possess this technology. and they have been using the jamming technology against South Korean satellites since August of 2010. This actually violates the 1953 Armistice Agreement, but no action has been taken. After all, while jamming signals can be a nuisance, it's not necessarily dangerous. So, the international community has more or less just decided to let North Korea have a blast jamming satellite signals. And finally, the last major space threat from North Korea is cyber counter-space weapons. This includes hacking satellites and space systems from other countries to extract information or inject corrupt information. The North Korean cyber division is actually quite strong, especially after Kim Jong-un took over. However, Western countries seem to still have the edge when it comes to cyber warfare. So, in conclusion, NADA is not that dangerous at this point in time. They're able to jam signals and might be able to hack a few satellites. But in terms of physical weapons, it looks like we're good to go. Do you guys think North Korea is a serious threat? Comment that down below. Also, drop a like if you thought this video explained NADA well. And of course, consider joining our Discord community to suggest future video ideas, and consider subscribing to see more questions logically answered. But until then, I'm Hari, and I'll see you guys on the next one.